It's time for Windows Weekly. We've got a very special show for you. Aaron Hillegass is here. He is from Big Nerd Ranch and a Mac developer. He'll be talking about the new OS X Lion and iOS 5 with Paul Thurrott and how it applies to Windows. And Paul and I get in a massive fight all about Windows 8. It's all coming up next on Windows Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Windows Weekly is provided by Cachefly at cachefly.com.
This is Windows Weekly with Paul Thurrott, episode 212, recorded June 9th, 2011. You're just wrong, Leo. Windows Weekly is brought to you by Go to Assist Express. If you're an IT or software consultant, up your competitive edge and grow your business with Go to Assist Express. For a free 30-day trial, visit gotoassist.com/windows. And by Carbonite. Backing up the files on your PC or Mac is safe and easy with Carbonite. For a free trial plus 2 free months with purchase, go to carbonite.com. Offer code Windows. And by Netflix. Watch thousands of TV episodes and movies stream to your PC, Mac, or TV instantly. Plus, get DVDs by mail in about one business day. For your free 30-day trial, go to netflix.com/twit. It's time for Windows Weekly with Paul Thurrott, the editor-in-chief of the SuperSite for Windows, winsupersite.com, news editor for Windows IT Pro, and, of course, the author of Windows Phone Secrets. We've got a great guest in-house today, Aaron Hillegass from Big Nerd Ranch. He's the guy in the cowboy hat. Great to have you, Aaron.
It's a pleasure.
But we're going to ask you to sit back for just a moment, because Paul and I have words. For those of you who didn't watch TWiT on Sunday, John C. Dvorak and I were pretty dismissive of Windows 8. You disagree, Paul?
But I think the...
But is it not possible to say, we'll see, and I'm skeptical?
Yes, but it is wrong to say this is wrong, that this won't work.
Well, it's that's John. I mean, John's not. John's never been one to say, we'll see, you know, it could be good, it could be bad. John's job, and he's a pundit, is to say this sucks. But I can't say I disagree with him.
John's job is not as a pundit to say it sucks. John's job is to say that everything sucks, and that's his
Well, shtick. He does do
and
that.
It's just, oh, no, but it's just what's the big news story, and here's why it's wrong.
Right.
You know, I mean, and after a while, it gets like, yeah, okay. You know, listen, you know me well enough. We've been doing this for years. I have been very down on things that don't make sense. I have, in fact, given all the stuff that happened with Vista and then the lackluster response to Windows Phone, you see how I react to things that really don't go well. And I look at this and it's, you can't say, oh, there's Thurrott again disagreeing with Microsoft does. I mean, I look at this and I think
never
this is something
that
could work.
I've never said that. No. You know, in fact, when you talked about it yesterday, I was completely...
No. I don't mean you. I meant one. You know, I don't mean you specifically.
If you say something's great, I absolutely listen to you. And that's what last week I was saying, wow, this is exciting. But I think John had some points.
I doubt that that's true, but I'd like to hear about one of them.
Well, the point that I would say is the salient point is it possible to do one?
That's not a point; it's a question. See,
Microsoft asserts. Wait a minute, Microsoft asserts that it is.
Microsoft has never said that.
Well, but isn't that what they're doing by their actions?
I believe so.
Yeah,
but I mean, I think that's the point.
So then the reasonable, and again, there's no argument until you actually try it. But the reasonable,
there's no argument. Period. What happens when Windows 8 comes out, and they actually, as it turns out, you know, enterprise desktops just ship with the regular desktop. You know, we actually don't know what they're doing.
I agree.
So
I agree.
We've only seen a small all this stuff where it's what I'm saying is Microsoft, from my perspective, from my vantage point, has done something that Apple, like Aaron said, or other people like you guys, believe isn't possible, which is created a single UI that I do think is going to work effectively across all of these usage scenarios, all of these user types, all of these device types. And it's not a touch interface. It's something that will work with Kinect and with voice control, with keyboard and with mouse. It's something that will work on servers. It will work on business desktops. It will work on consumer machines and tablets and phones. And you can disagree with me, but you can't assert that that's what Microsoft said. And you can't just say it's wrong because we've only seen a single freaking screenshot. I mean, and by the way, the fact that we're even
we've seen more than that. We saw that whole demo.
A screen. Okay, fine. But we don't have it to play with, I guess.
No, we haven't touched it.
The fact that we're even having this level of discussion, to me, says they're on the right track. We were just writing off Microsoft 2 weeks ago, Leo, right? This is the company that can't innovate, the company that doesn't understand the consumer market, the company that should leave the consumer market. And then they come up with this, and all of a sudden we're having a raging debate. And I think that that alone is beautiful.
Well, there's innovation and there's innovation. I mean,
okay.
Just because something's new doesn't make it great. and we don't know. I'm not disagreeing with you that we don't know. And I also don't think though that it's completely off track to have an opinion about it.
But I want the opinion to be based on something that makes sense. So
what if I assert that Microsoft has attempted with this UI, as you just said, to make a one UI to rule them all? And what if I were then to assert, I don't believe that's possible because I think you have to acknowledge the abilities of a mouse, the abilities of a keyboard, and the abilities of touch. They are very different, and it's not possible to make one UI to rule them all.
But why? What about that makes it impossible? Where is the thing that you're not?
Well, it's like saying, I'm going to make a universal hammer. You can make it a screwdriver, you can make it a hammer, and you can make it a saw. Yeah, you can make such a thing. Would one want to use that?
It's actually not like that. Because I mean, that's a cute example because it makes it seem like those are three different things. But ultimately, you're interacting with objects on a screen in this user interface. I guess my point is keyboard shortcuts will make it happen. Mouse actions will make it happen. Touch gestures will make it happen. Your spoken word can make it happen.
But if I'm of the opinion, if I'm using a mouse and keyboard, I want the Windows 7 interface. I don't want big tiles that slide around.
I think of it more like this. When you're having used Windows Phone and having seen the benefit of not having to dive in and out of applications all day long to get information, like the weather, that you have an email, what your next calendar entry is or whatever, that there is a nice benefit to that style of UI just from a presentation standpoint. Yes. If you're going to go in and write in Word, you want some rich application that allows text editing with a keyboard. If you're going to use something like Photoshop, you want that rich interface that Photoshop offers. There's no reason those applications can't be launched from this beautiful UI. In fact, that literally creates this kind of best of both worlds scenario, which is what I believe is what is occurring here with Windows 8.
Well, as you say, we'll see. I mean, I don't like the full screen interface online either because I think that that's a step backwards. I think a full screen interface, on the other hand, on a tablet makes a lot of sense. So, I don't like multitasking on a tablet or an iPhone. I think the attempt to put multitasking in there is crazy. The problems on the iPhone come from the fact that
it's a Windows PC. I mean, it is a Windows PC. So you're not going to get rid of its one of its top five benefits. I mean.
That's a challenge for Microsoft because you can't truly innovate because you have to leave Windows 7 under the hood.
That's always the problem, right? Is killing something off and saying we don't need that.
That's their big challenge. And Apple is going to start facing that as they grow in market share. It will become very difficult for them to start making changes.
But culturally, Apple has always done that. They've always been willing to say we're going to make an MP3 player.
Is it cultural or is it business driven? I think it's business driven.
Well, by the way, I think it's both. But the problem is those are going to clash, like Leo said. You know, it's easy to say, by the way, we're going to drop Classic when you have 20 million customers.
Right.
But if you have 500 million
it's
customers.
It's a lot harder.
It becomes a different thing. I mean, Apple has always moved very aggressively to, drop iOS support from the earliest iPod Touch or iPhone or whatever, or, move forward to new iOS versions and everything. But, it becomes a little harder when your market is a mass market,
One thing I can say, and I was actually shocked, is that this discussion that John had, and I suspect that it's a discussion that's reflected in the outside world as well, stimulated a huge response from Windows fans, and I think it's probably should be very gratifying to Microsoft because I really thought Windows fans had kind of given up, and they still care as much as any Apple fanboy, absolutely.
But that's my point. I mean, my own reactions I think have mirrored what happens in the wider Windows community or whatever, which is simply that, you know, A, we tend to be less passionate and less religious about these things than Apple users for what I assume are obvious reasons. But, you know, we've kind of taken a back seat from a news department, you know, from a news standpoint, from an excitement standpoint for years. And I think we're collectively kind of tired of it. But on the other hand, you have to be sort of resigned to it. You know, when Microsoft does what they do and they come out with these, whatever they come out with, and it's, you know, not necessarily that exciting. I mean, you can't feign excitement. I'm not going to do it. And, you know, I just react accordingly, I think. So I think the way I said this last week, if I remember correctly, was something along the lines of, you know, this thing is scary and that's why it's so exciting. And the truth is we really don't know much about Windows 8. I think it's amazing that we could have this level of a debate at this early standpoint, but it shows you, you know, there are over a billion people out there using Windows computers right now. And I think a lot of them are just sick of the continual bad news. A lot of it, which is just...
Well, I know. You've been very morose for some time.
But it's a reaction to reality.
Right.
You know, so this is not an act, Leo. I mean, I am whatever I am, but I mean, I just react to the way things are. I mean, I'm excited about Windows 8 because I believe that what they've shown so far is, in fact, exciting and innovative and interesting. And actually, a lot of my talk, you know, I've written a lot about how I believe that this is, like you said, one UI to rule them all. A lot of that is almost like a, not passive aggressive, but a way for me to push forward something that I really hope Microsoft is doing. Because, like I said, they've never actually said it. But that... I hope they understand, because, you know, I've been disappointed before, what they have, you know, how amazing this is, if they could pull this off, and how when I think about the other scenarios, which they have not shown us, you know, lockdown business desktops, IT pros and admins who have to control servers and interact with servers, you know, the media center situation, although since then they've shown Xbox where you would interact with the, you know, your HD TV. I look at this UI and I think this would work for all of these things.
I just think it's funny because, I mean, I'm getting stuff like this from Dimitri. Leo Laporte, I can excuse the real Dvorak, but you, Leo, are claiming I'm being proud for being a journalist. You didn't lack blood like one. It's like, right, I'm not supposed to say bad about Microsoft.
You should say whatever you feel, and I think maybe that's the point. But, no, well, hold on a second, Leo. But my problem with this is simply...
Or, like, I'm somehow biased because I didn't think Windows 8 was the best thing ever happening in the world.
This.
What you've got is people like Dimitri. Now, Dimitri works for Microsoft, which he doesn't disclose in any of these tweets, by the way. But
well, okay.
But
he only has 140 characters, Leo.
But, you know, I'm biased, but he works for Microsoft. But the real issue is that what you're accusing me of, which is judging something based on some screenshots, is happening on the other side, too. People have decided that Windows 8 is the greatest thing since sliced bread based on the same screenshots.
Okay, so... my point simply is this, though. It's not that I care. I would like you, I mean, like any other human being, I would like you to agree with me all of the time. But the truth is, I'm very much open to an opposing opinion. I just wish it was consistent, you know, because I feel like you reacted in this a certain way last week, and then you reacted to it on this Twitch show with Dvorak in a completely different way. And I think
I'm going to have to re-listen to it because I didn't realize that I was.
I think John was being very dismissive.
Was I? Is equally dismissive?
He's like the clown prince of the tech industry. I mean,
he was expressing a reasonable point of view.
He throws a grenade in the room and then he sits back and he rubs his hands.
That's John.
You know, it's a cute thing to do, but I just don't know that that's a legitimate debate tactic.
And in my defense, I do trust you a lot. And so when you're singing something's praises and say it's really great, I'm listening to you. I hadn't had a chance to look at all the videos when we started doing the show, and I did during the show and then looked at more afterwards. I don't disagree with you, and I don't disagree with John. I do agree that we won't know until we play with it. I do think that there is a fundamental issue, which is that it's very difficult, perhaps impossible, and perhaps a foolhardy mission. I guess that's more what I'm thinking.
Well, no, but I mentioned the phrase Monday morning quarterbacking a couple of times last week, and it's because of this. In the past,
Friday afternoon quarterbacking, right?
Okay, but you know, but
the game hasn't even been played yet.
With the understanding of what that term means, in other words, a lot of people after a Sunday football game will talk about the game on Monday and say, "Oh yeah, I knew it was going to turn out that way," and you know, as if they actually had any understanding. Well, the truth is, before this, I have had discussions, not just with you, but elsewhere and in writing and so forth, where I've agreed with what Aaron said, which is simply that, you know, Apple looked at this device market and said, we're going to build from the ground up, not strip stuff out and build from the top down, you know, that kind of thing. And that those are the two different approaches you can make. You can take something big and heavy like Windows and you can whittle away until it comes down to something that you think will work on a tablet. Or you can take something small and light and beautiful like iOS and you can move it up a little bit and it works on a tablet. So those are the two approaches. I agree, in theory, that the second of those two approaches, the Apple approach, sounds like the one that makes the more sense. Having seen this, my eyes have been open to the possibility that this could actually work, which is something I wouldn't have believed before. And now, and again, it's in a Monday morning quarterback kind of sense that I look at this and I say, ah, okay. And it's not just because Microsoft almost had to do something like this. Remember, their market is so big. Their backwards compatibility is the backbone of everything that Microsoft does. And so you think that this would hobble them. But when you look at this, I see the possibility that this could, in fact, work. That's all.
I think it's a possibility, but people say, well, you said it was the biggest thing. This is Windows 95, and you agreed with Paul, and I do agree that this is a huge deal for Microsoft. Yep. It is the biggest thing since Windows 95, but that doesn't mean it's a success. We won't know until we actually get to use it.
And that's the thing. So there may be more information about Windows 8 this summer. I don't know, but we do know that in September, Microsoft is going to have this build conference. And my expectation, again, they've never actually said this. So a lot of this is just, it's not me pulling ideas out of my butt. It's more like, based on my experience with this company and the way they handle things with Windows 7, especially because the same people are in charge of this, my expectation, my very strong belief, is that we will see a beta version of Windows 8 at the build conference in September, along with a full revelation of the complete feature set of the product, exactly what they did with Windows 7. And then we'll know. You know, and then we'll also get our hands on it, be able to use it, and then be able to say something a little more intelligent about it. I fully expect Dvorak to be all over the map on this thing, by the way, over the next year.
Oh, yeah, he hated the mouse. I mean, it doesn't mean, because he hates something, doesn't mean it's not going to be a success. But I think he raised an absolutely legitimate point, which is it possible? And both he and I are skeptical that it is, to create one user interface that works. And why would you want to, I guess, would be the other question.
Yeah. So, right. Why would you want to? This comes down to why would Microsoft want to?
Right. Why? What would be the
reason Microsoft would want to is obvious. Why would we as users want this? I think is a question of how well this UI works across all of these usage scenarios that we talked about. And again, I think about this stuff a lot. I look at this stuff a lot, and I think I see no problem with this. You know, we'll see.
I think that it's almost like, I mean, people are, it's so funny because, I mean, when you have people who treat this as a religious war, then you're expected to choose a side and right or wrong.
This is like someone telling you that I get that you believe in God and in heaven, but because you are not in my exact sect, you are not going to heaven when you die. I'm sorry. So enjoy you rotting in hell, you Mac-using bastard.
It's kind of like that. And I'm not... Look, I couldn't care less about Apple or Microsoft. I care about users.
Sure. Right.
But again, this I'm merely expressing some concern that I didn't express last week, I admit, because last week we were just looking at it for the first time, and it's very pretty. But I do think John raised some really, admittedly, in his confrontational style, which is John... some legitimate concerns about, is this really a sensible plan?
I think, I don't know. I will dedicate my life to proving you wrong, Mr. Laporte.
And I will prove you wrong, my friend. You know,
I will clear everything off my plate for this very thing.
John and I have had, you know, remember when the iPad came out, John and I had a bet, which he lost, that they would sell 5 million in the first 9 months. John and I don't agree on everything, and I'm willing to make a bet. It's premature to bet on Windows 8. I think that there is, you cannot fail unless you attempt to take a risk. And I think that all we're really saying is that Microsoft has made a big bet on this.
Yeah.
Well, it remains to be seen. They may hedge their bets as they have in the past.
That alone is reason to be excited because, again, you know, we talked about this. They do Windows 7, which is a very evolutionary update to Windows Vista, fixed all the problems there. Nice job. But now what? You know, and you get this feeling, well, they're on this evolutionary kind of path. Like, this is how this is going to go. I mean, we'll talk about the Lion and iOS stuff, but those are two other mature platforms, frankly, very evolutionary stuff, right?
Well, that was the thing that we had presupposed, and we'll give Aaron a chance to talk in just a moment.
Yeah, no, we will talk about that. But I mean,
but that was one of the things we had presupposed, is that Windows, that operating systems had evolved to the point where there wasn't much you could do that's new and different.
I would argue that maybe innovation is sort of ending on the desktop. Maybe it's time to just take Windows 8 and burn it onto a ROM, and it'll just be inside your computer when you.
Well, that may be true too. Hey, let's first of all,
one thing. So, but this is just like the Office ribbon was for Office, which is we assume that productivity apps could never really be innovative or new or different anymore. What's a word processor is a word processor is a word processor.
Well, that's true. What could you do with Word? I mean,
they came up with the ribbon UI. Well, the people who did the ribbon UI are doing the Windows 8 user interface. Right. It's the same team.
So. I think some of this, too, is that you have this great trust and respect for Steve Sinofsky. I don't know the guy from Adam. So you have more of a ground of being for saying this is going to be good than I do. I don't know who he is. So
he's
you have a lot of respect for him. I know you do.
I have a chip in my head that makes me not be able to criticize the man. But the point is,
and to be honest, I have a lot of respect for you. So if you
if I could walk around that slight limitation, I'll just say no. I do have a lot of respect for the guy. Yeah. And this is the guy who ran Office and they did the ribbon. He runs Windows and they do Windows 7. He's got kind of a track record,
right? So so some of this comes from. Your opinion about Steve Sinofsky and my respect for you, and if you say Steve's a good guy and knows what he's doing and this is going to be great, then I have to say, well, that's exciting. But if you ask me, and from a purely objective point of view, not knowing the players in this, looking at the idea of taking of this tiled thing, I think it also has a great potential for being another Microsoft Bob.
I don't think there's any chance of that happening at all.
I wish there were some bet we could make.
There is some bet we could make.
What would that
what
be?
What could it be?
Well, look, even if it's Microsoft Bob, it's going to sell 150 million copies, so it can't be that.
Yeah. It's not going to be Microsoft Bob.
I don't know how he would know.
But see, the thing is, I don't actually think you believe it's going to be Microsoft Bob either. So,
No, I'm just saying that to sound more like the Vorak.
Right. I mean, in other words, that's a very extreme thing, but I think that. I really believe that this is going to be hugely successful, actually, and that this is going to.
Well, it almost can't not be, you know, just because it's Microsoft.
So I guess.
I wish there were some objective.
Edition, so.
Well, that's true, but I wish there were some objective kind of measurement that you could say, well, there isn't, because it's going to sell 150 million copies.
So here's one. I mean, this is kind of a geeky thing, but, you know, within a year of this thing's release, you know, Microsoft has this WIM data that they use. They can tell you if people turn it off.
I know. Here's how we'll know. If Apple adopts it in the next version of OS X.
Well, based on what I've seen this week, it sounds like they will.
Oh, well, that's good. Let's talk about that. By the way, those of you who are just joining us, we started the show in the middle, and we'll just put a beginning at the end and an end at the beginning, and then it'll be done. Paul Thurrott.
I guess we should start by apologizing to Aaron.
No, because I want to introduce Aaron. I thought this is a good way to begin the show,
Aaron,
frankly.
In World War I, they had trenches. And they beat the crap out of each other.
You are on the Maginot Line right now.
You were in the middle of that.
Paul Thurrott is here. He is, as you gathered, the editor-in-chief of the SuperSite for Windows, winsupersite.com, Windows IT Pro News Manager, and the author of many great books, including Windows Phone Secrets, and soon to be, I'm sure, Windows 8 Secrets. And the host of this great show, I'm Leo Laporte. And we started in the middle because I think this was a great discussion. We got, as I mentioned, we got a lot of heated email. Not a lot. I got 10. Heated emails from people who said, oh, you and Dvorak were just so dismissive of 8. You're full of it. You're biased.
Yeah.
Which I disagree with. But, of course, I'm biased.
I don't, honestly, bias to me is not the issue. I don't think it matters. I mean, bias, what does that mean? You know, you're not like a...
I have opinions.
A god on an ivory throne, you know, rendering judgment upon the land.
Oh, yes, I am. So you did an interesting thing, Paul. You said, why don't we, because Lion, you know, Microsoft's talked about Windows 8 now. On Monday, Apple at the WWDC, the Worldwide Developers Conference, took, you know, we knew a lot about Lion, but took more of the wraps off of Lion, its next operating system, and off of iOS 5, the next version of the iPhone, yep, iPad operating system. And so why don't we get, and I think you're a bold man, Paul, why don't we get an Apple developer in here to talk about
it? Not that bold. Aaron's a good guy.
Well, he's got a nice hat. Aaron Hillegass is here. Aaron, yep, is the guy at Big Nerd Ranch. And as you have in front of you, Aaron, I have been a fan since the original Coco program. That's my copy.
That's it, with the 1970 style cover.
Yeah. I was going to say, was that made by monks in a castle?
It's sepia. You don't see many sepia tone books these days.
So let me put in a quick disclaimer, right? I worked for Next. I was never an Apple
you
guy.
You worked for Next?
I worked for Next. I was never an Apple guy until it became Unix underneath. I'm actually a Unix guy from way back. It's just that now the Apple is a Unix machine. And
yeah, it is. No, I'm with you on that. And, you, of course, Objective-C is your thing, your
That's
baby.
Right.
And Aaron's company, Big Nerd Ranch, teaches how many programmers a year how to write Cocoa software? Hundreds and hundreds.
Hundreds and hundreds.
Yeah, it's a really great program. Alex Lindsay went through it for the iOS.
That's right.
And we're thrilled to have you
and
here.
And Paul is coming.
Now, why would you do that, Paul?
Aren't you
loyal to your team? I think you're wearing some different rainbow colors there.
Let me show you my boxer shorts. The truth is, people don't know this or forget it, but I have a software development background, and I've always, as the platforms we use have changed, you know, to these mobile devices and to the web, I've become interested in this stuff again. And with the iPhone in particular as a major new platform, I investigated what at the time was iPhone OS programming back in 2007. And I've always had Macs, installing the developer tools, getting in the developer program, doing that stuff has never been a problem. But this is very much in keeping with my years, decades long belief that you need to keep up with what's going on with all of the major competitors, you know. And when I look at things like Android and iOS compared to, say, what Microsoft's doing, I don't look at it just from a user experience standpoint, but also from the software development standpoint as well. I mean, I think that the APIs, the capabilities that developers have, the services that are available and all this stuff is very interesting. So
I also have to say that regardless of mm-hmm. what idiom you program in or what OS you program in, this is one of the best courses for programmers in general. Aaron's books, and I think you're going to have a blast.
We do both iPhone and Android. I should also put that little plug in.
Yeah, he does Android too, yeah. So, we had lunch last month in Atlanta when I was there for Tech Ed, and I had met him before that. He keynoted one of our developer shows. And, you know, remember Aaron asked me, he said, you know, how did you find me? How do you know, why me? And investigating this stuff online, I mean, I came across the Big Nerd Ranch stuff, and I knew immediately this was the guy. You know, X-Next, they do this course, these courses both at their own facility and then on-site for people. They had written books and everything, and I could tell this is the guy. Like, you just know in this industry, like, who knows what they're talking about and who doesn't. So years later, when it came around for my own company to do this developer show, I thought of Aaron. And I have to say, I mean, I haven't done the course yet. I will in August, but I wish that we had stuff like this, and hopefully someone out there can prove me wrong, that I don't believe we have anything like this on the Windows side, and we should, you know.
Well, so I think Aaron, what he does is...
I'll start working on another book right away.
A .NET? Would it be .NET? Is that what you would do if you were going to teach...
Yeah, .NET would be the analogous thing to Objective-C and Cocoa. And what's really interesting, and I think Paul's pointing this, is the fact that Windows 8 and Lion, they are evolutionary. And I really do think that you could burn them on a ROM and be happy with that operating system for a decade. What's happening right now, all the innovation is happening both on the internet and on mobile devices. And so if you really want to know what's sort of the future of programming, you need to look at Android and iPhone and Windows Phone.
I think it would be a big mistake, and I think maybe both Apple and Microsoft might be making this mistake, though, to be so influenced by all the innovation happening on the mobile platforms that you start to incorporate those into desktop. I really do think they're different idioms.
I do too.
Well, let's talk about that, because obviously Apple has done very specific things in Lion, which we've seen, you know, Launchpad and whatever. So there are UIs. There are also conceptual things in Mac OS X that they're doing based on their experience with the iPad that I think are much more successful. The MacBook Air obviously was influenced by this stuff, the instant on stuff, the application autosave, and the auto, you know, the resume stuff. But we know less about how Microsoft's going to handle that simply because we're just a little too early in the game. But I mean, what do you? I actually think that cross-pollination makes sense. I mean, and as these mobile devices become the primary computing platform for more and more people, I think that's what they're going to expect when they turn to a computer.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are going to be adapting the iPad, and then maybe later on when they think, well, now I need a word processor, maybe I need a desktop system, and they're going to expect it to act a little more like the iPad, and that's why some of these user interface idioms that would not be obvious for a desktop system are being brought to it.
Well, and that was my question last week when we looked at Windows 8, is if there isn't, and I think I mentioned this on TWiT, I hope I did, if this really doesn't reflect the fact that there's a group of people who know how to use computers, who love computers, who everybody who watches this show, we're geeks, yep. We're nerds. And then there, as Apple discovered with the success of the iPad, there's a whole bunch more people who don't want a computer. They want the capabilities, but they don't want the complexity. They don't want a file system. They don't want a desktop. And so my reaction last week to Windows 8 was that this might be the solution for those people. This might be the operating system of the future. The problem that everybody's going to face is that there's a legacy, a group of people like us who want a command line, for crying out loud. You know, that's one of the issues.
Truck drivers, we call them.
Yeah, we're truck drivers. That's what Steve Jobs called them.
Yeah. It's funny, when he said that, I thought that was just something dumb. And as time goes by, again, in a very Monday morning quarterback sense, I have come around to the notion that he was onto something. It's a shocker, you know.
But it's a challenge because
the primary industry seer of our day would have been onto something earlier than me.
What a shock. But,
yeah.
But it's a challenge because that's two different, very different groups. And, you know, when we were doing Tech TV, I did two shows. I did the Screensavers and Call for Help because I felt that there were two kinds of computer users. Never the twain shall meet. There's the group of people, seriously, there's enthusiasts who are willing to go through hell and have bloody fingers using this stuff because they care about it, they love it. And then there's people who just freaking want things done. And those are two different groups. And I wonder if there's a way to reconcile the two on the desktop.
The enthusiast group is the small one, though. That's the problem. And I've made this comment before about Apple's audience. You know, Apple's success over the past decade has been driven largely by enthusiasts, and very extreme enthusiasts in some ways. But as Apple's market for their users gets bigger and bigger, you know, the percentage of people who there are like true technology enthusiasts is dwindling. So they become this kind of vocal minority. I mean, I think the reality is, it's not the geeks who have like iPods and iPhones these days. These are like people, like my kids and my mother and, you know, people that just don't care one way or the other.
But it's interesting to note that I think that Apple's really reconceiving themselves, that they're no longer competing with Microsoft, but rather in consumer electronics. They think of Sony as their competition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and so
they're repositioning themselves. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
You know, I actually bemoan many of the changes Apple made. The App Store to me scares the hell out of me. We've talked about this before because I just see a world where people don't buy apps on the web. They buy everything on the App Store, which means all the apps that I like Handbrake, Apple's never going to allow. And so we're going to start living in what Virginia Heffernan of the New York Times calls a gated community, which is safe. And everything works and secure, but there's no fun.
And as a developer, Apple will always be taking 30% of whatever you produce.
Well, that's probably worth it given that you get in the store, they do all the downloads. I mean,
but a lot of companies already have that infrastructure. True. You think Adobe wants to give Apple 30% of everything?
Good point. Right. So I'll tell you what, now that we've all made peace and kissed and made up and I apologize
I'll never
for the,
forgive you.
I apologize for
continue.
The tongue, Paul, but I think just force a habit. But let us take a break. I am actually, this is a great conversation. I love this conversation. I think this is exactly why we created TWiT, is so that these kinds of battles could rage among people who care passionately about computing, the future of technology. If we didn't care, there'd be no freaking point.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
And just like that, I suddenly agree with you.
I love you too, Paul. I love you, man.
No, and in fact, really, I have a huge respect for Paul. And if Paul says this is going to be good, I'm absolutely willing to defer judgment until we see that piece of crap. And then I'll let you know what I think. Hey, by the way, I did this morning, I did a great seminar. I had so much fun on the future of work, and it is available online. I'll give you a link in the show notes because, in fact, I'll have to make a shortened URL or I'll tweet it because you can download this. And I did it with the folks from Citrix. Actually, it was a GoToAssist sponsored it. It was a webinar using GoToWebinar. And I had so much fun. And one of the things we really talked about is how work is changing so completely, so dramatically. Our notion of what a job is, what a career is there even such a thing as a career anymore? How all of us need to be entrepreneurial going forward. It was a great discussion, and I hope you, it was mostly a monologue, but you know me. But I hope you get a chance to listen to it, and I thank the folks at GoToAssist for inviting me to do that. GoToAssist is the tool for the software consultant to the IT professional who needs to solve problems. By the way, they are a non-combatant in this war, Mac or PC. In fact, you can use GoToAssist on a Windows PC to fix a Mac or on a Mac to fix a Windows PC. How about that? How about them apples? GoToAssist.com/Windows right now. You can try it for 30 days free. So why is GoToAssist a support tool? Well, of course, it's using the great Citrix remote access backend. It's the best. There's nobody better. They really know how to do it. It's straightforward. It's easy. 128-bit SSL, so it's secure. It's easy for your assistees. You know, if you're doing support, you can't really ask the person you're supporting to go through a complicated tech setup just so you can support them. GoToAssist Express is so easy. You send them a link. You can do it in a chat. You can do it via email. They click the link. 30 seconds later, the software is installed, and you're in there. You're fixing the computer. They can chat with you. You could show them your computer. You know, if you're a Windows user and you want to say, see how much easier it is on Windows, you Mac nitwit or vice versa. You could do 8 sessions at once. I think that's really important for support because frequently you'll start an install or a scan, and then what are you going to do? You twiddle your thumbs, you play Quake? No, you go to the next machine and the next machine. On average, GoToAssist users, the IT pros who use GoToAssist, report about a 40% increase in productivity for that reason alone. You also can do an assay of what hardware, operating systems on there, what security software, what's running in the background. You can drag and drop files from your computer to theirs, fixes and patches and so forth. It is just fantastic. I want you to try it free. 30 days. GoToAssist.com/Windows free for 30 days. I think you'll like it. Paul Thurrott is here. Aaron Hillegass is also here from Big Nerd Ranch. And believe it or not, we're talking Windows. I didn't know you do an Android.
Oh, yeah.
I want to take the Android class.
Yeah, you can't ignore Android. I mean, so many devices.
You could try.
You could try. I would be foolish to do it.
You could try. Big Nerd Ranch is famous for its cowboy hats.
I try and wear
the
cowboy
hat. Can you lift your hat just so that people say he's bald? He's not bald.
There's the hair. No.
You know, I can't believe I forgot my hat today. Dang. I have a great
hat. You have a whole rack of hats.
Yeah, and the cowboy hat is at home.
Ah.
Damn it. With my boots. And my shirt with the frills. Paul, have we had the conversation? Do we not? Is there more to talk about on Windows 8, or should we move on?
I think we can move on. No, let's not move on. Screw you.
I was waiting for that. So this is going to be a little challenge for some of you. There are people.
Yeah.
I think it's a minority who say, I don't want you put peanut butter in my chocolate. I don't want any apple in my
Leo,
Windows
Weekly. I've been Weekly. Dealing with this since 1995. You know, get over it.
This is a show about technology, about operating systems. It's focused on Microsoft.
It is Windows writ large. I don't believe that anyone buys a Windows PC and uses Windows. Windows is part of an experience that you have. It's the foundation for a lot of it, but it is something that exists in a world with other things, and these things all interact. I bet today that the vast majority of people who own iPhones have Windows PCs. So this is perfectly okay.
I think something interesting that's going on in the Apple community that maybe may not be as obvious is this whole ecosystem developing around it. And this new iPhone, the iCloud announcement, really ties these devices to the cloud at a personal level. And I think we'll be seeing something similar from Microsoft for too long, developing that similar analogous environment.
So, yeah, you know, I was talking to my friend Raphael, my Windows Secrets co-author, and I was saying, you know, I think the biggest success of iCloud, which, of course, we haven't even seen yet, really, but assuming it works as indicated and so forth, is that Apple, it's not like they've invented anything, but they've done something very classic Apple, which is to take little pieces from all over the place and give you this cohesive experience. It is really a superset of what Mobile Me should have been if they had gotten it right on day one, right? Because Mobile Me is a good idea. It was basically Exchange ActiveSync for consumers. Smart. I think that what they've done is very smart. Now, it would be possible as a PC user to cobble together all of these capabilities. But you would have to take a piece over here from Dropbox, a piece over here from Remember the Milk or whatever, a piece over here from SkyDrive. There is nothing on the Microsoft side that is one thing that is directly analogous to iCloud. And I think that's the success of it. You know, that, and it's so typically Apple, and I think that's why it's important to discuss, even if you have no plans to use it, because this is something you should look at as something that you will be using something like this, if not this, in the future, because it makes so much sense.
And Windows people of the world, let me point out, there is libraries that you will be able to do Windows applications that access iCloud as well.
Oh, that's interesting.
Right,
so yes, there's an API.
Right. Yeah.
There is an API that will exist on Windows.
You know, Steve, during the presentation said it just works, I think, account 14 times. And I think that that might be secretly the positioning against something like SkyDrive or Microsoft solutions. Well, is you don't have to think about it. It's just built in, right?
And it's free. I mean, that's sort of wild that they're giving 5 gigabytes of hard drive space on the cloud.
SkyDrive's 5 gigs, right?
Okay.
SkyDrive's 25 gigs.
25 gigs.
But the problem with Sky, you know, but we've talked about
but
this.
But it doesn't just work.
When you talk about the sullen, you know, my sullen reaction to things, you know, Microsoft has 25 gigs of online storage. Microsoft has a online office productivity suite that's sort of, you know, in there. They have a live mesh thing, which is sort of connected to it, but not really. They don't have a way in Windows 7 to connect to your storage and use that storage as backup of your PC, of your PC settings, of, you know, for documents, you know, seamlessly. You can't file save as and have the location be SkyDrive, not natively, not in Windows 7. And, you know, when you offer something but offer no way to use it, it's almost worse than not having it, you know? And I think, unfortunately, that's been the Microsoft experience with that kind of thing so far. And that, again, that's why I look at something like iCloud and I think, yeah, okay, you know, from a Windows perspective, you may be thinking this is like this really Apple-centric lock-in kind of solution. But, you know, that, again, the strength there is they've tied all this stuff together into a cohesive service. And I think that that is a big differentiator between that and what's available on the Windows side.
Right, and Apple would argue that the cloud is ubiquitous, but the user interface for the tablet device versus the desktop should be totally separate. And now Microsoft is saying that the user interface is going to be much more of a touchscreen experience regardless of what sort of a device it is.
Yeah. Potentially. I mean, so you're there, obviously, so you've flown out to San Francisco for the show. Have you had a chance now to look at any of these new APIs, whether we're talking iOS 5 or Lion or this iCloud stuff? I mean, have you seen anything in there that sticks out in your mind? Have you looked at it at all?
I've been poking around with it a little bit. You know, it's been a busy week, and I can't talk about any of it. And besides the keynote, everything is under NDA.
Of course. Okay.
So I have seen the glories, and I can't tell you about it.
I didn't mean to stick you out on the plank like that. Sorry, I forgot about that aspect of
it. That's all right.
Okay. So would it be fair to, could you describe your actions being positive?
Watch. No, everything's been great. We're all really happy about the changes. On the desktop, the changes are very incremental, as you're saying. They're very evolutionary. Yeah. On the mobile devices, the changes are a little bit more radical. We're still really feeling out how our mobile devices are being used in the real world, and Apple is adapting to that. For example, all the Twitter integration that's now part of the operating system. You can see that that's a response to how people are actually using their iPhones.
Yeah, fair enough. I mean, right. So, this was controversial for some reason, but I mean, I've said for years that these platform makers all copying from each other is kind of a crass way to say it, but they basically copy from each other. You know, you can look at what the competition is doing and say, oh, like, look, you know, this thing's successful. We got to do something like that. And everyone does that. And so, you know, obviously there's some stuff for Windows Phone that you see, we kind of see now in iOS or stuff from Android. The Notification Center, for example, I think looks a lot like the how notifications appear on that slide down panel in Android, if you're familiar with that.
Yes, very much the same.
Yeah.
iMessage, a huge improvement.
Absolutely, because the thing that was there before, or the thing that's there now, is a text modal, you know, dialogue, essentially, that kind of pops up and interrupts you. I think that, you know, I mean, I guess we're a little hobbled by not being able to talk about the new stuff, but I mean, just talking about these platforms generally, I mean, what do you see as with regards to a consolidation of, you know, these kind of user experiences? I mean, are these things all merging into the same, you know, the same basic usage patterns? I mean, it's almost like for a little while, one of these things will have something and then the next guy picks it up for the next release. I mean, is that basically just how this goes from here on? I mean,
well, I think you had a really interesting point in that when you're number two, it's easy to innovate because you don't have to worry about backwards compatibility. And it's similar with a new device. When you roll out the iPhone, you're not hampered by your existing customer base at all. And it gives you the opportunity to innovate really quickly. And so people see the features coming out in Android and Windows Phone, and they're saying, hey, a lot of these are copied from Apple, and we're so proud of ourselves because we thought of it first. But Apple has never been reluctant to steal things from other people, steal good ideas. Right. And so just because they're in the lead and they aren't hampered by as big a customer base, they've gotten to innovate more. But I think we're going to see the feedback between all the platforms increase more and more. And it's going to look more and more the same.
What do you? I saw today that you probably, not that you would have paid attention to this in particular, but Microsoft now has separately released these cross-platform tools for developers who want to move from, or not move from, but develop in both iOS and Windows Phone, and then more recently Android and Windows Phone. I mean, with your experience developing on both Android and iOS, I mean, is cross-platform mobile development today is basically a mess, right?
It's a total mess. I mean, everybody wants it, right? And no one wants to maintain three code bases of their applications. But the reality is that when you use a cross-platform tool, you really get the least common denominator. What everybody has, you can do. The special stuff, you can't take advantage of. The performance is not terribly good. A lot of the frameworks rely on actually doing an HTML5 application, which is, I think, much more limiting than writing a native application. It's something we all want. I just don't believe the technology is there. And I haven't seen Microsoft's solution, but I'm very skeptical, as Leah would say.
I think it's just an API. It's almost like a flow chart. You know, you need this API on iOS, so here's the equivalent on Windows Phone. I believe it's some kind of thing like that. It's just a tool that helps you bring your code over.
What we've been working hard at with our company, because we do iPhone and Android applications, is that we try and move some smarts onto the server, out into the cloud. So the data that you get is a little bit pre-digested before it comes down. And then the client side, we can make it native, we can make the user experience great, but we make the application itself as small as possible.
Does Apple, it's funny, we had this debate at work, I mean, with regards to the event you were at. I mean, does Apple allow you to sell what are essentially HTML5 apps to the store, or is that just something you have to?
What you do is you do an HTML5 app, and then you wrap it inside what we call a web view, and you make it look like an app, but really it's just a set of a web application or a set of web pages. You can do it, but people recognize that you're not really doing the best you can.
Like we lost Leo there. Are you okay? Leo?
No, I'm here. I just was letting you guys talk. One question.
Go ahead.
No, you go ahead, please.
No, I was going to say, we should step through some of the neat stuff that they did announce. I mean, and see if there's anything that stands out in particular. I mean, the public stuff.
I'll tell you what. Why don't you do Lion? Because I think then iOS is a whole nother conversation, because really, basically, they stole everything from Android and Windows Phone 7.
That is sort of true, yeah.
So let's talk about Lion.
I mean, I'm looking down the list for me. I mean, I there are the things we talked about earlier. You know, there are iOS influences. You know, full screen apps, which I, by the way, is sort of, you know, is the Lion Windows 8 start screen stuff in a way.
I know. I hated that full screen apps thing.
Well, except for one thing. So the thing I think that Apple is doing right in Lion, and Microsoft may do right in Windows 8, we just don't know, is it's a toggle. You know, if you launch iPhoto or the new Mail app or Safari, you know, in Lion, they launch as applications, floating windows. But there's a way to make them go full screen if that's what you want. And I think that's smart, actually.
I actually agree. I think it's neat that you can toggle it on and off, so you can go into a multi-window situation if you need to. The thing that concerns me is, first of all, I use a mouse. At this point, yep. Lion is almost unusable with a mouse. You really need a multi-touch.
Because the screen is humongous, screen. Basically? Or
well, because you need to do three-finger gestures, and it's hard
I
to
hate
do those.
The freak. I'm sorry. Okay, I'll say something I hate.
Yeah.
The reliance on gestures, to me, is horrible.
I agree. I'm terrified of when my mom gets Lion and I have to walk her through how
to... Oh, mom, you got to do this, and then this, yeah. and then this woof. And you're not doing it on screen where gestures kind of make sense.
Right.
I mean, a pinch on screen makes sense because there's a direct correlation between what you're doing and what you're seeing. On a trackpad, on a big mistake.
Yeah. I'm going to spend a lot of time on Go to Assist.
Yeah.
Well, this speaks to something I've said about Mac OS X generally for a long time, and I have and will point it out for Lion, which is that... You know, Apple positions this as a kind of an easy-to-use, user-friendly system. But, you know, those gestures that you're describing are not discoverable necessarily.
Not at all.
Not at all.
There's a place you can look, but you have to know where to look.
Well, that's what I mean. In other words, and honestly, I expect most people will trigger gestures by mistake the first time.
Absolutely.
And that's how they'll discover them.
Definitely
not. Even the first time. I've turned off. There's a gesture on current OS X that makes things shrink. And after shrinking my browser text inadvertently about 100 times, shrinking my icons on the desktop inadvertently about 100 times, I had to turn it off. That's what will happen is we will disable these stupid gestures.
The Microsoft version of this is I have a Microsoft mouse, so there's a different version of the mouse software you get for that. And the back button on the mouse by default doesn't do back. Actually, I'm sorry, it's the forward button. The back button does do back. The forward button is not forward by default. It's like a screen magnifier. So I'll be browsing around the web, and I want to click the button to go forward. You know, I go back, and then I want to go forward, and then the screen, you know, explodes, and it catches me every time. The first time I install this thing, every single time I do that once, and then I go into the control panel to get rid of it, you know, because you just forget that it's there. But it's just those kind of things. Like, it doesn't really make sense. You make the mistake, and then you've learned something.
Well, I mean, that's my point, is that it's intuitive and obvious on a tablet where you're touching the screen, and it's doing something. Maybe the five-finger sweep isn't, but most of those are. It is not intuitive and obvious on a laptop or desktop.
Sure. I agree.
So, you know, Launchpad is another one. iOS, I find that to be incredibly unsuccessful, personally. I don't even know what it is.
Can you describe that, Aaron?
Yeah, so Launchpad just brings up the icons of all the applications that are installed on your system.
It's another kind of expose.
Yeah.
So we have this thing, which I also never use. No, it's
exposé.
Currently called exposé.
Exposé. Well,
now mission control, and you get it through a gesture, and it groups your windows according to applications. So exposé is actually better in this release. But then Launchpad is just a listing of your applications. I'm sorry, Paul.
Yeah. I think of Launchpad as being the equivalent of the iPad home screen, right? It's just a grid of icons.
Right, and I think that will be little used
specifically.
As well. It is not unheard of. In fact, it happens almost all every OS X release that there are a dozen or half dozen features that are put in that are never used.
Yeah.
Or that only some people use.
Well, by the way, the power users who are going to use something like Mission Control will love it and rely on it. But they are a very tiny minority of people. And much like these other gesture-based things that you can trigger, I realize there's a keyboard control too, but most people who enter that environment will do so by mistake, you know, and then they'll wonder what the heck it is. You know, it's like this weird UI. So I don't know that there's anything like that on Windows. I mean, obviously we have task switching keyboard shortcuts and yada, 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 but I mean, nothing like an infrastructure like that. You know, Mark Rozinovich wrote a way to have multiple workspaces on Windows, which is an underlying capability, but we don't really have it, you know, in the base UI. Is there anything in Lion that sticks out for you as being,
you know,
the thing that makes this, you know, the gotta have upgrade?
I'd say one thing that I think is very significant. Two things. First of all, $30. Second of all, only available on the App Store, which presupposes that you A, have broadband because it's 4 gigs, and B, that you have Snow Leopard, because that app store doesn't exist on previous versions of OS X.
Well, but you know, what's interesting about both of those things is they speak very much to who the Mac community has been, at least to date, which is people who tend to upgrade, right? There aren't a lot of people using Tiger, you know, right. today or whatever. And by the way, people who have money, you know,
right?
I mean, people who own Macs are not on dial-up, Leo. You know, I mean,
but that's a shame. I think that's a shame that you would assume that.
Well, they're expensive machines. I mean, I think that those people are going to have broadband. I mean,
I guess you know. There must be. We don't know, but I would imagine there'd be a way to buy it some other.
I think there must be. I mean, if only for the security agencies, right? I mean, if you
got to have a disk.
If only they had a physical store to match the virtual store.
I imagine that's what'll happen, but I don't know if they'll do a shrink wrap. They said they won't.
They said they wouldn't.
I can picture them doing a download for you at the store and then putting it on a SD card or something. I mean,
there is apparently a way to open the file and find an image that you can then put on a USB key or CD. So there is a way, and the Apple, I'm sure, will have a button that you press.
I was wondering about that. Yeah, one of the things I got wrong about this early on, because you know it's hard to find out information right when it's announced, is that you know when you download something like that to the store, you know you already own a Mac, so your Mac came with Leopard or Snow Leopard, and now you want to reinstall. A lot of people like to go from scratch, you
Me
know,
too.
When a new.
Yep.
So now what? You know, I mean, how does that work? Do I have to reinstall the Snow Leopard that came with my Mac and then upgrade to Lion immediately? And you know, off the top of your head, it would seem like that would be the case. But I've been told since that they actually create a restore partition, which is what we do on the Windows side.
Is that what they're going to do?
That's what they're going to do.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. So that's smart. I mean, that's smart.
Yeah. I don't know if that's under NDA, but.
Well, because Paul said it first, you're okay.
This is out there. It's out there.
Paul said it. You merely nodded.
Nodded along, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But please, Aaron, don't violate your NDA.
No,
I won't. You can't talk about.
I actually completely forgot about that.
If you've done the pre-release versions, you know how to do the install, but you're not allowed to talk about it.
Right. One of the reasons we don't, in fact, cover anything at the WWDC except the keynote is because nobody's allowed to say anything. So we just go home and we wait till somebody whispers to somebody else, and then we can cover it. It's very weird. But I understand what happens.
Aaron, anything?
You do understand, because I don't understand why Apple keeps so many things under NDA for so long. I mean, it's not like the people at Microsoft don't know what they're doing.
You know, the irony is that Apple, I don't know if they've changed this, but in the original iOS, they told developers that developers couldn't talk to other developers about issues with iOS, and that is a huge disadvantage for a developer.
We actually had that problem because we started teaching iPhone development before it was out of the NDA, and the way we worked around it is that we put all our students under contract. You were allowed, I found a loophole, you were allowed to talk about
if they worked for you.
So I hired all my students and they had to produce a line of code, and I paid them $1 at the end of the week and signed a contract, and that's how we got around it.
That's great.
So so I think that that's significant, and I suspect that we will see something similar. We're going to see an app store in Windows 8. I'm sure that's the case.
Oh, yeah. That's one of the very common rumors and revelations and all that. I think that's an absolute certainty. In fact, there was a store tile in the demo they did. So there's stuff I think we need in Windows, and then there are these things that I see them doing in Lion, which now I believe we need in Windows, which is you know, the ability, I guess this is sort of an iCloud thing, but, you know, the ability to back up a profile, blow away your machine, and then get your profile back. You know, the ability to have that stuff be something separate that you can kind of back up and fix, you know, and not worry about blowing away your system. But, you know, there were features that they showed, like the autosave stuff and versions. I mean, and Windows does have a thing like versions. They just don't have a good UI for it. But the ability, you know, this is like core infrastructure stuff. And it's it's very much needed. I think on any OS, any modern OS should have this stuff. You know, the ability to close an application and come, you know, bring it back and have it come back the way it was and not have to worry about saving those documents, you know.
Right. In a modern operating system, you shouldn't feel like you're being punished for doing something a little bit dumb.
I'm a writer, right? So my hands are on the keyboard all the time. And I can assure you, in fact, it would be funny to monitor your keystrokes and find out how often you do this. But in the course of a day of all the writing that I do, I must hit the key combination Control-S 1,000 times a day, because you do it reflexively, not because my Windows computer crashes every 5 minutes, but you just have this thing in your head. I don't even think about it explicitly, but I mean, I must have this notion. I have to, you know, save. you know, the space save.
Yep.
You know,
I do that. I mean, that's all writers write. Do that.
Yeah. Because, you know, we've been burned once.
Right.
And anyone who's lost anything, whether it's code or text or whatever, I mean, that's, you know, that's one of the ugliest feelings ever.
Yep.
So I think that stuff's cool and necessary.
I'm trying to think of other features that are, we knew so much about Lion before this speech that weren't a lot of revelations.
I like the notion of bringing, making apps simpler and more, when appropriate, more like their mobile equivalent. So for example, on the Lion side, they're doing that with Mail, which I thought was actually, just seeing the demo of it, I thought it was effective. There's the version of that in Windows 8 with the IE application, IE 10. Where it's gonna, it runs as this full screen app with no, you know, window Chrome, and it kind of looks like a, you know, it's a, looks like a mobile app. I think that stuff's cool. I mean, I don't think it's appropriate for everything, but I think when you can apply it where it makes sense, that it can be very effective.
I think sandboxing is sort of an interesting thing. Is that you'll be able to have applications run within their own sandbox where they can't touch a lot of different things on your system, and we should see some improvements in security just because. Yeah. When you download an app from the App Store, you don't have to give it permission to do anything it wants.
It's been available from third-party products on Windows for a long time, and it really is a great, sandboxy is a great feature.
It's interesting to see that Apple's doing things that were sort of enterprise-grade, like virtualization and the cloud, and making it actually appropriate for grandmothers.
It's the enterprise in the box for grandmothers.
That's right.
It just works. And that's their challenge. I mean, that's really what they need to do.
Always.
When you have an operating system like Windows that's really targeted at the enterprise, perhaps you can do things like Windows Home Server that are a little more enterprise focused, or a little more nerd focused. But Apple, you know, I think Apple's lost its way years ago and ended up being just as complex as Windows, to be honest with you. And now I'm bemoaning it going in the opposite direction because I think a lot of what Apple's doing now is dumbing OS 10 down.
I this app, you know, obviously this argument has been made about this Windows 8 thing as well. And as much as the power user in me also recoils against that, I lovingly embrace this future because I really think it's important. You know, we talked in a very general sense about how, you know, iPads were going to increase in complexity and in capability. They have to, you know, to improve. But that Windows or any kind of computer, you know, has to, in the same vein, adopt some of those things that make the iPad great, and simplicity is one of the, you know, key bits of that. I mean, it's amazing what we put up with on our computers.
And maybe that's why the one operating system for everybody won't work, is because you're not just dividing up technologies, you're also dividing up demographics of your users.
That's precisely my point. I would say if you're dumb, buy an iPad or a Windows tablet or whatever, Android tablet. And if you're a nerd, keep your freaking hands off my desktop. I want a Unix command line. I want mouse and keyboard controls. I don't want tiles.
I think what Microsoft, to kill this metaphor, I would just say that, you know, there are cars and trucks, like Steve Jobs said, but they're also crossover vehicles.
So this is a utility, all-purpose utility vehicle. And that's where in a nutshell, that's where I'm skeptical.
It's fine to be skeptical, but...
If they can pull it off, more power to them.
It's just that you're wrong, Leo.
No,
you're so very wrong.
Okay, that's how you feel.
There's no need to respond to that.
Oh, you're right. I should just say, you're right, Paul. And now a word from Carbonite.com. Actually, we're going to come back in just a second and talk about iOS, and which, you know, as I'm watching the keynote, and I know I wasn't alone on this, I'm going, wait a minute. That's from Windows Phone 7. Wait a minute. That's Android's notification. Wait a minute. So a little homage, shall we say. We'll talk about iOS 5 in just a bit. And by the way, Paul, just so you feel good, the show title, You're Just Wrong, Leo, I think is going to be the show title.
I was kind of hoping some rotten hell would get in there somehow, but that's fine.
Rotten hell, Leo Laporte. Hey, I was at E3 and I saw Modern Warfare 3, and I think you're going to like it.
I am gonna like it.
Oh boy! Did you see what we? Did you see what they did at the booth?
Yes. Oh no! What did they do at the booth?
So Brian Brushwood and I are at E3. We covered it live.
By the way, every time you say his name, who is this person?
You don't know Schwood? Oh, you'd love Schwood.
It reminds me of the guy, the character from Monkey Island, Guybrush Threepwood or whatever.
Guybrush Threepio. He is
every
like
time
Guybrush.
You say his name, I think of that.
He's
game.
Got spiked hair. He's a professional magician, very well known on the college circuit. Seriously, does a show for Revision 3 called Scam School, where he teaches people how to win bar bets, scam stuff, free stuff. Okay. But does a show on our network called NSFW, which is a just hysterical show that you've got to watch with Justin. R. Young, J.R.Y., and it's just a great show. And then he's also does a show with called Frame Rate with Tom Merritt. He's one of our hosts. You would love him, but he's also a serious gamer. Glenn Rubenstein and he and Tom Merritt are going to host our new gaming show at the Controls, and they will. They were with me at E3 because I'm a gamer like, you know, an old fart. I was a gamer, you know. I remember Centipede. So. Why can't more games be like Asteroids? But it was fun to go. It's always fun to go down there. So the folks who do Call of Duty had a booth. It was kind of interesting. It was just a big open space with a stage in the middle, and then screens all around you. So we go up there, and they've got a countdown going. They're showing trailers, and they got a countdown 6, 5. So we said, well, we got to stay. So we stayed. Then there was another countdown after the countdown. It was a countdown to the countdown. And then after the countdown, and then it's jam-packed, they showed an amazing trailer from Modern Warfare 3, full surround. You've probably seen it now by now on YouTube. But, you know, all the you know, Paris, London, New York. Yep. Did you see the water sequence with the my God, it's incredible. Underwater as well.
Black Ops is such a piece of crap. Why do I put up with it?
Oh, and by the way, we also looked at Battlefield 3, and you know, the guy,
look.
Yeah, awesome, and the guy came up from EA and said, tell Paul, he was German, tell Paul Thurrott, we will get him off of Call of Duty and onto Battlefield. Nice. Yeah.
They've been threatening me with that for years, but...
You will be getting a copy
when
of...
When is Battlefield 3 coming out, do you know?
I don't know if they set a date. Does anybody know in the chat room?
Hopefully before Modern Warfare 3, because after Modern Warfare 3, I'm going to be a little busy.
October 25th.
Perfect.
But I have a feeling, it's a battle for Paul's heart and mind.
I have room for both.
They both want
you. I'm a loving person, Leo.
They both want you badly.
I want them both badly.
Yeah. Well, this guy who's so great, he's a huge fan. He kept saying, where is Thurrott? Where is Thurrott?
Nice.
He loves you, and he really, really wants you to become a Battlefield 3 fanatic.
I like Battlefield a lot, actually. I mean, I
know you do, because it's the same game.
No. There's a very different feel to both the general playability of it, but also the multiplayer is completely different. It's a different style of game.
All right.
It's obviously modern armies running around killing each other, but it's... They really do have different feels.
I'm going to Tatooine to be in the Old Republic. I won't be shooting any modern warfare guns. I'm going to be riding my speeder across the desert. Anyway,
I understand the desire, but
it's you're looking at these and going, who has time, really?
Yeah.
Who only people like Paul Thurrott, who don't work for a living, have the time.
Leo, I probably wrote like 50,000 words in the past 7 days. What are you talking about?
Have you really?
I've written a lot.
That's impressive. I've spoken 500,000 words in this show. So there.
Well, I... So...
Hey, we're going to take a break. This whole time we've been doing a Carbonite ad and you didn't even know it. We're going to take a break and come back in just a second. Aaron Hillegass is here. He is from the Big Nerd Ranch, bignerdranch.com, a great place to learn programming, Android or iOS, and maybe soon .NET.
Sure.
Why not? What the hell? Paul Thurrott, of course, our host, as always, and the man who loves Windows 8. But first... You know, actually, Carbonite, if you're getting ready for these new operating systems, I know we're going to get Lion next month, Windows 8 next year, but when you move to a new operating system or you want to do a clean install, you will be really glad you have Carbonite installed. Carbonite is the best form of backup. It shouldn't be your only form. I want to make this clear. Nobody should rely on a single form of backup. That is not the way to do it. You want two different kinds of backup. You want at least 3 copies of your data if you want to be safe. How many of us are sitting here with data on our phone, our computer, our laptop, that we just, if we lost it, we'd be crying. You know, great pictures of your wedding, your babies, music, financial records, all the stuff that's on your system. You cannot afford to lose it. So backup is critical. And the thing I like about Carbonite, it's automatic, so you don't have to think about it. Whenever you're online, it's backing up using SSL, so it's secure. You can further encrypt it if you want. You can use Steve Gibson's PI principle, pre-internet encryption, to make sure it's safe before it goes to the cloud and private. And then you can get to it anytime. It's kind of online storage as well as a backup system. So they have an iPhone app, an Android app, a BlackBerry app. I'm sure they'll have a Windows Phone 7 app. They're working on it right now, soon. Log on to any computer to your Carbonite account. There's your data, all your data. And, of course, when it's time to change operating systems, upgrade, or redo your operating system, all you have to do is rewrite the operating system, log into your Carbonite account. There's all your stuff. You press the restore button. You're good. Try it free for 15 days, and I do want you to try before you buy. It's always important to do that because it does depend on your broadband connection and so forth. So try before you buy. Carbonite.com. Use the offer code Windows. You don't need a credit card, just that one word, Windows, and you'll have 15 days free. If you decide to buy, the 12-month subscription for Carbonite is a mere $59, unlimited, all the personal data on your internal drive for $59, and we'll add 2 free months when you use the offer code Windows, 14 months for the price of 12. Carbonite, you got to back it up to get it back, so do it right with Carbonite, carbonite.com, offer code Windows, Windows. So am I crazy, or did iOS 5, well, look, we're at the point now, Apple innovated hugely with the iPhone, but maybe we're at the point now where, it, like operating systems on the desktop.
Actually, I think what Aaron said earlier is correct. I mean, Apple is in the position with iOS where Microsoft is with Windows, essentially, where they have an established base now. It's different. I mean, obviously, when 2007 happened and the iPhone first came out, this was hugely innovative, completely different from everything else. They've been copied up, down, left, right, and sideways by everyone else in the market since then. But, you know, you have a market of people who expect certain things now. And, you're seeing evolution. I think it's fine. It's just that we tend to think about Apple in terms of, you know, exciting innovation and everything. And for people like us who understand the market and what other companies are doing, you kind of go down the checklist and you're like, seen it. Yeah. Seen it.
It's hard to do something you know, new at this point.
Right. And Apple fanboys deny that Apple takes ideas from other places. But honestly, yeah. Apple is not too proud to take a good idea and add it to their operating
or
system.
Or steal it, as in the case of one developer who got turned down in the Apple iTunes store for the iPhone, did it in Cydia, made a very popular application, which Apple, the cloud backup, which Apple basically, they not only took his app and his idea, which is anybody's idea, but they took his icon. That's cold, Apple.
No, that's a lot tough. Of the features in iOS 5 are things that you used to have to buy apps for. I mean, basic image editing. I don't know how many people are making their lives off of doing basic image editing iPhone applications. And Apple said, why should you be paying $9 extra? We'll just put it into the operating system.
Right. Well, and that makes sense. And that happens all the time. Yeah. Here's the icon. This is the Wi-Fi sync program that Apple turned down on iOS. That was on Cydia. That's the icon on the right.
Yikes.
Apple's icon on the left. It's a little similar.
This is the double-edged sword that is dealing with Apple, I think, from a developer standpoint, right? I mean, there's always that chance.
Greg
that
Hughes, the guy who wrote Wi-Fi Sync, says, obviously, I was fairly shocked.
I don't know. I mean, I understand where he's coming from, but is it really that surprising? I mean,
it's kind of unconscionable, but, you know. Apple's Apple.
Well, but it's not unprecedented.
No.
Far from it.
And they're consistent.
Ask Will Shipley of Delicious Library.
Sure. They're still, I mean, they introduced Newsstand, which is like the latest example of an app from Apple that uses that Delicious Library style UI. I mean, I realize the guy didn't invent a wooden bookshelf, but my God, do they use that again and again and again?
Yeah.
I mean, that's true. You can't really copyright a trademark, a wooden bookshelf. Anyway, what do we think of iOS 5? Do we want to talk about it, or should we just move on?
One of those interesting cases of enterprise for grandmother, enterprise technologies for grandmothers, is the idea that SMIME mail is now going to be there on the mobile device.
Encryption and signing.
I have no idea why we haven't been encrypting and signing our mail all the time. I mean, would there be a spam problem if everybody signed their mail?
I use for a long time I used GNU Privacy Guard, and I kind of wish they supported that. That's the open source. But I've been using S/MIME certificates on my Apple desktop mail and on my Windows desktop mail for years, because then if you get an email from me and it's not signed, you know it's forged. I don't encrypt, but I sign.
Exactly right.
And it was always a sore spot that I couldn't do this on the mobile.
The one that shocked me was iMessage. So now they're going to have their own unified messaging system that's going to get around the SMS charges. If you're talking to someone
carriers have to hate that.
Oh, the carriers must really hate it.
Yeah.
I'm sure they're...
Good. Screw them. That kind of stuff is...
Couldn't happen to a nicer bunch.
Yeah. It's no problem with that.
It's actually, I think, really an homage in that case to BlackBerry. The BlackBerry Messenger, it's funny, I would never have thought this, but the BlackBerry Messenger is very popular, and BlackBerries are very popular in high schools because the kids don't want to do text each other. They want to IM each other, and BlackBerry Messenger works great. But it has the same problem that Apple's iMessenger, I think, will have, which is that you have to use an iOS device, right?
It is, yeah. iOS.
So... Is it conceivable? Is there an API? Is it conceivable that Apple will open it up so I can do this on Windows Phone? Or
I can't answer.
I love the expression on your face is priceless. It is possible.
You know. So that's why the carriers aren't going to get too upset, because you really have to be sending it to somebody with an iPhone or an iPad.
Sure. Right.
By the way, you know, I wrote a story about this, but, you know, the guy, Joe Belfiore from Microsoft, wrote some quick tweets about some of the features, you know, that were already in Windows Phone, and they all basically pan out. But the one that I think is most entertaining for me, because I had personal experience with this, was last summer before I got a Windows Phone, I drove cross country with my dad, and we finally got to Colorado and pulled into the place where he owns a second home, and he saw a deer. And we're in this little Volkswagen convertible. And he says, oh, my God, a deer, you know. And I had an iPhone 3GS at the time. So I pulled the thing out to take a picture. And, of course, it's like a bar of soap, you know. So, it squeezes up through your hands and you catch it in the air. And then I have to log on. So you hit the thing. And he's like, quick, take a picture. You know, I'm like, oh, hold on, you know. You hit the button, you swipe, hit the NEM, you know. You're on the wrong screen, so you have to find the right screen where the phone is. You have to launch the app. And then I bring it up, and what I have a picture of, which is priceless. I might have put it on Facebook. It's a picture of a tree that looks like it has a deer's tail on it, because the deer was gone. It was like right in front of the car. It probably walked 40 feet while I was trying to get to this camera app. And you know, one of the big features of Windows Phone is what they call this pocket to picture thing, where you can, without logging into the phone, access the camera, but nothing else. You know, you can't even get to your stored pictures.
That was the best thing about Windows Phone 7, I thought.
Maybe. It's the fastest way to take pictures of the inside of your pocket.
Yeah. Well, no, yeah. I mean, you hold down, the camera button makes a little click so you know that it's engaged, and then you can use it from there or whatever. But it basically is working exactly the same way now in iOS 5. I mean, they don't have a dedicated camera button, so they use...
Yeah, they do. They have the shutter button. Well, yeah, right. They use the volume.
Well, no, but that won't enable it. You still have to turn the device on, and then you can tap the...
Well, that's,
you know,
the
virtual button on the screen.
Exactly.
But I mean, as close as they could get within the confines of what they have, you know, from a hardware button standpoint. So I thought that was cool, because, you know, Microsoft even made I think they made more than one commercial. You know, there was a skydiving commercial where the guy's trying to take a picture and he never deploys his parachute, right? Because he has an iPhone and he can't get the thing to take a picture. So they've apparently addressed that burning need.
And people cheered at the conference for that one feature.
They're actually, somebody in the chat room said this, they're calling it the Anthony Weiner feature.
Yes.
Makes it easier to take pictures in your pocket.
Yep.
Okay, we're going to move on. By the way,
yes. Speaking of Anthony Weiner and the Weiner problem.
Yes.
One of the things that's interesting about iMessage is that it synchronizes to all your devices.
Yikes!
So if your wife is on the couch and you're sending pictures to co-eds, she may know exactly what you're up
to.
That's
one of the things that actually concerned me a little bit about iCloud, is this notion that...
I know.
Is how they solved the idea that people don't trust cloud storage. It's like Dropbox without... I presume they're going to have selective syncing, but it's like Dropbox in the sense that it goes everywhere.
You know how Apple works, right? It won't have selective syncing right away, but they will add it.
Right.
And in the latter, because people will want it and they'll ask for it, and maybe it will be at that September event where they have the iPhone thing or the iPad thing the iPod thing, or maybe at some future iPhone thing. And then everyone will cheer because, you know, Apple's done it again. But I think And, you know, Aaron, of course, can't confirm or deny this, but unfortunately, but my guess is out of the box, V1, it's going to be kind of a, yeah, it's just on. To me, that's a little, well, it's typical, but it's a little odd because I don't necessarily want every song that I buy on all my devices. You know, I have
To be fair, at least the way they've done it in iTunes and the screenshots I've seen of iOS 5, and Aaron can't talk about it because he's seen it. But there is, it looks like behind, next to everything, there's a little cloud icon with a down arrow. So you have two choices. You can go one by one and download everything. Or just Aaron, just, you can nod. Yeah. You're not on camera.
No, that was in the keynote, so I can speak to it.
Okay.
And the idea is that you can download particular albums or playlists or songs.
So there's some granularity.
There's a picture of a cloud. And you click on it. It gets added to your local store.
Good.
Yeah, I mean, my deal would just be, maybe everyone's different, of course, but I mean, my iPad, I don't want music on my iPad, you know, for example. I have a low amount of storage on my particular device. It's enough for, you know, a few apps and some movies, and then I'm kind of done from there. And you want something that's at least granular enough to handle that.
Right.
Okay. Boy, that really petered out.
No, we need to argue about it. So...
Screw you, Thurrott. You know, I don't even use an iPhone. I have an iPhone, but I really don't use it. I kind of almost don't even use the iPad as much. I've become more and more of an Android fan. I was really glad to see that they took the notification system from Android because it really needed to be updated. And they've added some things because not just notifications, but live widgets. So there's a weather widget that will update automatically, a stock widget that will update automatically. Mm-hmm. So you've got the pull-down notifications.
It's funny to me that they would do widgets on that separate slide-down UI, which, you know, conceptually is sort of like that dashboard environment that they have in Mac OS X, right? They don't allow these things to intermingle.
Right. You can't put it on the desktop.
On the home screen, but they do have this other screen, you know, where you can... So you can't have weather at a glance, but you can have weather after a swipe.
Weather at a swipe.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Paul, and I think that that's a very typical Apple thing, where it's a matter of taste, Paul.
Yes.
If you had any taste, you would understand.
Listen, my limitations here are... legendary.
Let's talk about smartphone growth expectations.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, I don't know if we've talked about this before, but I'd like to get your take on this. It looks like the agreement between Microsoft and Nokia that's been going on for some time has a clause that says Microsoft can buy Nokia whenever they feel like it. Is that accurate?
I've not heard that. No.
Yeah, and so that really
that doesn't seem possible. Are you sure?
Unless I dreamed it. Let me do a search for it.
Given the modern internet, that story no doubt appeared somewhere online. I'm just saying.
But is it true is the question.
Yeah, I don't. That doesn't make sense.
Implying that, Nokia's been downgraded three times in the last 2 weeks.
Yeah. You know, Nokia's CTO went on a leave of absence today.
Yeah.
Which I'm sure is prompting jokes about how this guy's been missing in action for the past year anyway.
So anyway, who needs him?
I think that Microsoft deal was brilliant because what seemed to be happening was that rich people were getting the iPhone.
Right.
And then poor people were ending up with HTC or whatever running Android. And they really needed to make a play to be somewhere in the game.
And poor people were just buying feature phones from Nokia.
Yes. And so
by the tens of millions.
If you go to the third world, Nokia phones are everywhere. And if you could get Windows smartphones in their hands instead, that would be a huge market force.
One thing I've read again and again is that people from the United States, which of course includes me, do not understand the power that Nokia has over populations of these countries.
Right.
You know, that to us, they're just some random... Yeah, we've heard of them. You know, obviously, they're not really that big of a deal now.
No, overseas, Nokia is synonymous with phone.
Yeah. And even in like a first world country like Spain, where I was early in this year, I mean, it was astonishing how much Nokia advertising there was. And this was after their Windows Phone announcement, and they were trying to sell these new Symbian devices.
The E7 was everywhere.
It was really impressive. I mean, they looked like that global superpower they sort of still are, you know.
In fact, I bought an N8 because I saw those ads when I was in Paris, and I said, well, I have to have one, and it's such a piece of crap. So Stephen Elop said rumors that Nokia is for sale are baseless. Mm-hmm. amid reports that the CTO has taken an indefinite leave of absence, apparently because the Mego project. By the way, I did buy the N900 based on Mego also. I'm such a sucker for these ads. And it's another piece of crap.
I will give you a label I've given to a few other people, but you're like the patron saint of lost causes.
This was a lot. I thought, Linux on a phone, this is going to be great.
I own the domain name MegoTraining.com.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, nice.
I think you might want to sell that quickly because Mego is now being replaced by Windows
Phone. Seemed like a good idea at the time.
Which actually is somewhat of a piece of information. It means that Mego is being replaced, but not necessarily Symbian. I suspect they'll keep Symbian alive for the feature phones or the feature plus
phones. Yeah, I mean, I have a fear that Windows Phone will move down market for Nokia. And what I'm hoping is Windows Phone doesn't become like the equivalent of tomorrow's feature phone, you know? I mean, it really isn't conceptually because, of course, it's a smartphone, right? It has an apps platform and services and all that stuff, but it's the real deal. But I would hate to see Microsoft and Nokia come down with some really dumbed down version of Windows Phone that they only sell in wherever, you know, in Africa or whatever. Right. And, hopefully they don't do that.
I think they'll just phase Symbian out. I think everybody will have a smartphone before too long.
So IDC now is weighing in with Gartner and the other analysts on smartphones for 2011 and beyond.
This is kind of more of the same. I mean, you know, there since the beginning of the year, this talk has started where they look forward to 2015, and Windows Phone makes this miraculous jump from the bottom of the heap to number two. So, I mean, that hasn't changed. But I think the thing that's interesting here is just some of the numbers. I think I put this in the notes. You know, they were talking about 472 million smartphones this year. Smartphones, by the way, not phones, smartphones. That's about 100 million more units than the PC market will sell this year, to put that in perspective. They only sold 305 million last year, and they're expecting it to be almost a billion per year by the end of 2015. That's how big this market is. So when you look at the top three players, however this shakes out, you know, Android, iOS, RIM, and Microsoft, all of whom IDC believes will be in that mix. Even with Android taking, I'd have to look at the numbers, but probably for somewhere in the 40% range. Yeah, 44%. They believe that Android will be 44% of the market by 2015, which is not a huge leap over where they are today, actually. Even with 13 or 14 or 17 or 20% for the other players in that top four, that's a huge market. It's a huge market. You know, that's hundreds of millions of devices per year for all of these things. And I think that's what we're looking at. We can disagree about who's going to be where, but I think, and by the way, Symbian with nothing.
Yeah, that's sad.
You know, nothing.
And Mego with less than nothing.
Mego is
Mego.
Not even. Mego is the Amiga of the smartphone world.
Actually, I think they've renamed it to Mego Bye Bye. So maybe they knew somehow.
I think what's kind of interesting about these app phones is when I got my first sort of feature phone, it had a wallpaper you could change. The idea was you could sort of skin it to be personal. And nobody really cared about that. And skinning was always like, well, that's going to be the next big thing. But no one cares about that. But once you add the ability to download custom applications, you can customize your phone by adding new features to it. And that's a genuine sort of customization.
Yeah, your AT&T landline, it doesn't get an extra feature via some download. You know, you either have a rotary phone or a push button phone, but that's it.
And it's coming to the point where if you gave me somebody's phone and let me go through it, I could probably guess a lot about who that person was.
Is this another Anthony Weiner reference?
I actually meant by looking at the app.
Actually, by looking at the pictures, you couldn't tell. John Stewart said, I know Weiner.
That's not his.
You could probably tell a lot about people from the photos they take with their phone, too, but yes, I think that's accurate.
It's just in. the UFC Ultimate Fighting Championship?
No, but continue.
You don't know it? My son watches it.
I understand what it probably is.
It's like boxing meets street brawl.
Is it the thing with kicking?
Yeah,
is it
there's kicking, there's blood. And apparently they've just bought G4. I love it. Okay. Moving right along. Did you? We mentioned E3, but what we didn't do is a lot of coverage of the Microsoft press conference. We covered it on our coverage on Tuesday.
You know, it was what I expected.
Yes,
right?
Us too.
We talked about this ahead. You know, you said I might not even go to it or cover it, and I said, you know, the truth, you should, but there's no big announcement coming that we haven't heard about, right?
What do you think of the new Xbox UI? I mean, bye-bye Blades.
Beautiful. That's why it's exactly. It's perfect.
I agree.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
And that's because they've already made a half step toward it. If you looked at the dashboard change they made a year ago, or so ago,
right,
where they went from, they had this weird UI that kind of appeared to trail off into the distance visually. And what they switched to was a flatter thing where it just went left, right, up, down and was flat. I think was a preview, kind of a halfway point between the old UI and the one that's coming. So, you know, they make it look like that Windows 8 thing. And I think that's fine because, you know, these are big touch targets. You're not touching the screen, obviously, but I mean, you're using a hand controller or a remote control, or you're using that Kinect gesture where you're waving your hand in the air and, you know, you want to hit those large targets with your hand. I think that stuff's fine. So that looks fine. I like the flat look.
You know. They were Dance Central 2 was shown off, and they're going to have more. You can have two people dancing on the Kinect.
Neat.
I
accept that there are going to be Kinect games that are just like the Wii games of old. Okay, so we expect those things. There's the, you know, the Disney thing where you hug the air and you're hugging Snow White at a virtual Disney. Those things make me want to just throw up in my mouth. They're awful. But the thing that but they're expected, right? The thing that I did not appreciate was the attempt to bring serious gaming to the Kinect. You know, they did that Ghost Recon demo where the guy was, you know, holding the air as if he had a gun, and I don't know what he was doing with it, practice shooting or something. And, you know, sorry. That stuff, that's dumb. And I don't know. I just disagree with that stuff. All the games that I care about that were at E3, the Gears of War stuff, the Halo games, you know, Call of Duty, obviously, are games. They're like real video games. And the other stuff, it's like, it's either an absolute Kinect game, which you expect, and I just don't care about because I'm an adult, or it's some bizarre attempt to bring Kinect into a game that doesn't need Kinect interaction. And I don't know.
Because I haven't received enough vituperation from the Microsoft fans, I'm just going to show this little animated GIF from Imgur. It's their synopsis of E3, Nintendo, Sony, Microsoft. That's actually not strictly true, I have to say.
No,
should be really Sony with the eye poke.
No, Microsoft and Sony, I think, are in a similar place. Their consoles are not going anywhere anytime soon.
And they don't need to.
Because they don't need to. Not because of some weakness.
They're already HD.
Right. So, and then you have this Wii thing. I think Nintendo, I wrote, steals the show. The reason there is just because they had something big to announce. But the reason they have something big to announce is because their previously market-leading console has fallen off of a cliff because it's just, you know, run out of steam.
Yeah.
So,
no, they had to do it. I played with it a little bit. You know, it's...
Yeah.
This is another one where I will say it remains to be seen.
Yes. By the way, in a similar vein, though, I look at the Wii thing and I think this is not something I'm ever going to be interested in personally. However, I give them some credit. They always think outside the box. I describe this to someone as, you know, it's like the guys who run Nintendo are children and they just think differently. And they come out with this thing, which to them is so obvious.
Right.
It's just completely out of left field and it's so different from everyone else. And I just don't care about it personally, but I think it's going to be really successful. I think it's neat. I mean,
well, we have to see pricing, you know, because expensive peripheral they just announced. Yep. It's basically a tablet.
But there's no intelligence in it. So, I mean, it has a gyroscope and an accelerometer, but there's no microprocessor.
Yeah.
And there's no local OS or anything. So
that's true.
We'll see. There are questions around how many of those things could be. You know, do you notice there was a lot of talk about you versus someone, and someone's using the screen and someone's using the controller screen, but what if you have four people?
Yeah.
Can you all have different screens going at the same time?
You could if you spent the money on four different controllers. I think we saw a demo of two controllers at once at the E3. And, you know, in some ways it's like a giant Nintendo DS because depending on the game, you have the TV screen and then your controller has a second screen that you can
manipulate. Sure. So it's kind of like a DS.
I think there are some innovative things that can happen there. I think this is the way Nintendo does things. It's like, here's our idea, you know, and then next year we'll see the actual machine and have actual demos of it. And Nintendo will have some of their first-party games, and EA and some of the other big guys will show off stuff. And I think that's when we're going to see what these guys all come up with. And
I'll tell you one thing I will buy. Mm-hmm. Is Lego, is not Lego Star Wars. I'm an idiot. Is the Kinect Star Wars. That's going to be awesome.
Be like the Star Wars kid.
I want to be going. I haven't been able to use the Kinect. Dance Central is the only thing I really played with. I'm waiting for the killer app for Kinect.
I don't think you're going to find it. I think that's the problem. I think the killer use of Kinect from a UI standpoint is actually not the I'm waving at the screen. I think it's voice control. And they did a little bit of demo that.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
That's good.
Yeah.
If you've ever used a Kinect, you know, laggy maybe isn't the right word, but there's a performance thing where, you know, you kind of stand there like a dope and you're waving your hand and you're wondering why it doesn't see you, or you know, you're moving your hand around and the on-screen hand is moving, but it's moving like it's in molasses. And
yeah,
it's
that's no good.
It's just, it makes you want to say, forget it. And you just pick up the controller or the remote or whatever you have and kind of go.
What about the Vita, the Sony Vita? That looks, actually, I guess the question is, now that we all have phones that can play games, do we need a portable game?
That's the PSP I wanted when they announced the original and when they refreshed it a couple of years ago. And here's why. It has two of those analog hat controllers. That's what you need to do first-person shooters. And so for the hardcore gamer types, this is finally, and God, it took them forever, but this finally is a machine that can do that. So obviously Sony has their own games like the Resistance games, Fall of Man and Killzone and so forth. And then there are third-party games, hopefully like the Call of Duty games and Battlefield. If those things come out for that, that alone would make me buy this thing. In
price
fact,
is
that
right. $250
But now they have two. See, the last one had the last two had basically one of those.
Right.
And
two
it was
hats.
You need two because you need to be able to look around and you need to be able to move.
Thumb hats, we call them.
I don't know what we call them.
The rear pad is kind of cool too because your fingers on the back can do stuff.
Yeah.
It's gonna really generate a whole new group of people who are going like this.
Yeah, the other thing I generally speaking though, you know, the market for people who want that kind of thing, like I want, is very small.
Right.
And honestly, the future of portable gaming is not this thing; it's smartphones.
I'll probably buy
and
it.
Tablets. Yeah.
I think I've said that to everything on the show today. I'll probably buy that. Yeah, I'll buy it. I'll just buy it all.
You're so promiscuous.
I am. I'm a slut. I'm a technology slut. I love this. Microsoft fans is it Germany? Deface the Xbox, Apple Store.
Yeah.
Love it. That?
You love that?
It's hysterical.
Where am I?
I thought that was beautiful.
What, are you hurt?
Personally hurt.
Does it really bother you? I think it's a great.
I feel sullied. I feel like, you know.
I think it's worthy of Banksy. Are you kidding? This is awesome. Let me show you.
I thought it was beautiful.
They posed as building painters in Hamburg.
There's a great video where like these guys just walk up and go to work.
Yeah.
You know, and nobody questions them being there.
That's the key, I think, if you're going to do this.
Yes.
Is just do it with boldness. Mm-hmm. Just go, baby, go. Let's play the video because it's kind of fun. They just kind of... Yeah, we are here to paint the windows.
We wish to paint the windows.
So they got a ladder, and I guess it's going to be an Apple Store. And they put the Windows logo on it. They actually did a nice job. It's very 3D looking.
Yeah, it's very professional.
Yeah, I think this was, oops. That's the wrong video. I'm sorry. That's an Apple fan, obviously. Obviously,
I'm delighted to be here.
I love how sensitive they are about this.
Ah, the blue screen of death rears its ugly head.
For those of you listening, that was the video on this article. I guess I clicked the wrong video. I didn't do that on purpose. This is from the Mail Online. And what we saw,
that's
was
like anything else. I mean, these guys probably linked to the wrong video themselves because they did a cursory examination of it and said, yes, right, this is a video of the guys doing the thing.
At first, it looks like the guy's doing the painting, but then there's a blue screen of death at the end.
Yeah.
Frederick Dark, you have punked us! You Apple boy fans. I'm going to call them boy fans from now on.
It seems like just yesterday, Microsoft was the evil empire.
Yeah.
It has changed. It has changed. We're still getting used to it.
Now it's poor little Microsoft.
Poor little Microsoft getting beat up by Apple.
Speaking of poor little Microsoft, $300 million poorer thanks to the U.S. Supreme Court.
Yeah.
This is hard to believe.
This is a tough one because, A, they long ago changed word so that this stuff wasn't in there anymore, but whatever. There is a significant concern, a significantly real concern that these guys are just patent trolls and, that
we have a broken
patent system.
It's I4I. Is that their name?
Yeah.
I4I.
You know, the argument, so Microsoft loses this case again and again and again. They've lost every appeal they've ever
made. They went
made.
All the way up to the top.
And so they sort of changed the argument at the end, and it's tough because when you hear their argument at the end, you agree with it. You know, and the argument is simply, our patent system is broken.
Yes.
These guys are patent trolls.
Yes.
You're rewarding them for doing nothing. They have no intention of ever using this technology. And what we did, you don't agree, but we, developed it independently, and now you're preventing people from innovating because you've given these patents out to everybody, and they own nothing. But you make that powerful, and now they can, And so you listen to that, and you agree with it, maybe.
If you're a programmer, you totally agree with it, because programmers are always looking over your shoulder nowadays.
Well, look at that LoadSys thing for iOS, guys, and now LoadSys says they're going after Android.
But it's always haunting you as a programmer. Am I violating somebody's patent? Because it's really hard to find out, and some of them seem to me to be self-evident.
Sure.
So the Supreme Court ruled 8-0, but what they said, the ruling was very kind of limited. What they said was, look, you can say the patent system's broken, Microsoft, but the fact is federal law says a patent is presumed valid. If you don't like it, go to the patent office, not to the U.S. Supreme Court, because all we can say is the federal law says the patent is presumed valid. You violated the patent. The argument that the patent system is broken carries no water. 8-0, you owe I4I $290 million.
And their little argument about the patent system, it's like, yeah, that's cute, but we're not even going to consider that. That has nothing to do with the
It's not the issue.
Yeah.
I think it's obvious Microsoft probably spent a lot of money pursuing this all the way to the Supreme Court. Microsoft wasn't really, I suspect, you tell me, Paul, wasn't really about I4I. It was really about trying to get this patent system fixed. That's why they would go all the way to the Supreme Court.
So I happen to agree with Microsoft on this one, but Microsoft, of course, does this to other companies too. So it's hard to feel bad for Microsoft. I mean, it's nice that they were altruistic when it benefited them to try to do so, but whatever. $300 million.
Other side story is that Chief Justice John Roberts recused himself. He did not participate in the decision because
he owns Microsoft.
He has $100,000 worth of Microsoft stock.
I wonder how that's working out for him.
Well, it's worth exactly the same as it was when he bought it 10 years ago. All right, we're going to take a break, come back with picks and tips of the week. This is fun. Aaron Hillegass is here. We really appreciate your coming in. BigNerdRanch.com. I have the noob version of that book. You gave me, or no, you gave
I
me
did.
The
I
iOS
sent you
book.
A new copy.
But the iOS, but they're at home.
Yeah.
Because I'm reading them. This was the one in my bookshelf, Cocoa
the
Programming.
Next to his bed.
And we actually have a contest.
They are, actually.
Can I put a little plug in for my contest?
Next to my bed. What's your contest?
We are doing a mobile for global good contest. And the idea is you can send in an idea for an app that you think will help the world. In particular, it should be associated with some sort of a nonprofit organization. And if you win, we will send you to our class for free. And then you get to hang out with us for a week and we will help you write your application. So our little effort to give back is this mobile for global good. You can get the details on our website at bignerdranch.com.
That is awesome. Mobile for Global Good app contest right here. By the way, one of the best websites ever.
Thank you very
much. You have a great website. Did you guys do it or did you farm that out?
We did that.
Really?
Well, we had some help. We had some designers help us.
It's beautiful. I've always liked it. And what is it in? I mean, is it?
It is, and don't tell them Apple people.
It's in HTML, Leo. What do you mean?
It's HTML, and that's actually Flash.
Wow.
We are going to convert it over to HTML5 so that we will fall in line with the Apple line.
Have you looked at the height? Is this yeah. just an iWeb template, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah, it is. No, I wish. It would have been gone a lot quicker.
Yeah. No, look at Hype. I wonder if Hype will do the job
for
you.
Yeah, Hype is looking very promising.
It's really interesting.
It is very cool.
Yeah, it's an Apple app, Mac app on the App Store design, that's really designed to kind of give you a Flash-like interface, but the output is HTML5.
Right.
Very interesting. We're going to take a break, come back with more with Paul Thurrott and Aaron Hillegass, and our tips and tools of the week. But before we go much farther, I just want to briefly mention our friends at Netflix. We love Netflix. You love Netflix. If you don't love Netflix, because that's just because you haven't tried it. Netflix is that great system where you get DVDs by mail in as little as one business day. And now with Watch Instantly, you don't have to wait. Your gratification awaits you. Instant. Excuse me. I got so excited I hiccuped. Instant gratification. Great movies of all kinds. We watched Lord of the Rings last night. Instant. Nice. Very sweet. We interviewed Ray Kurzweil, you may remember, on Triangulation a few weeks ago. That movie about him, Transcendent Man, is now available on Netflix, instant watching. So here's the deal. Go to netflix.com/twit. Oh, I'm starting the movie. I probably shouldn't do that. That'll be a massive violation of copyright law, and the Supreme Court will vote.
Your $7.99 a month does not cover this use.
Yeah, probably doesn't. $7.99 a month for streaming only? Or you can have discs too, and I got to tell you, I just love it. TV shows too now. Shaun the Sheep, Battlestar Galactica. That's what I've been watching. Studio 60, Saturday Night Live, going all the way back to the first years. In fact, they've got the very first episode of Saturday Night Live on here. You're gonna love it. Netflix.com/twit. Try it free. Ooh, Hard Day's Night. Wow, Sid and Nancy. These are just the recommendations. Netflix.com/twit. Give them a try today. I know you're going to love them. And now, Paul Thurrott, if you have from you some tips of the week. Yeah?
Okay.
Tip number one. What do you want? Do you want a drum roll? What do you want?
So, the tip of the week is, this is silly, but I actually went through this process today and verified that it works. Unfortunately, it's U.S. only. But, you know, you have an avatar in Xbox Live that also appears on Windows Phone. And apparently they have, I just can't stand this kind of stuff. I just know people will enjoy this. They have props that you can add to these characters, like a little hat, like Aaron's hat is probably one of the hats. You can add a Windows Phone, Leo, to your avatar.
Yay!
On Xbox Live.
Can I have an Android phone?
It's a new feature. Yeah. It's a new feature.
Will they call me at my home?
No, it's just a little...
Hi, this is your avatar. You haven't played the game in a long time.
I actually didn't link to it for some reason, but it's on my Windows Phone blog. I think it's because I'm embarrassed by it.
Did you do it?
I did.
Uh-huh.
I did. So there. I think that the avatar is one of the dumbest things ever, and I hate... You talked about Microsoft Bob, and I hate this kind of thing.
But you have to have one.
You have to. That's what I hate about it. I can't turn it off.
Well, what do you want instead? You have to represent yourself somehow.
Just a picture, you know, whatever, a flower, a nest of eggs, a lighthouse. I don't know. I just don't want. I hate these things.
Yeah,
but anyway, there it is.
I'm looking at your blog. Which article?
No, WindowsPhoneSecrets.com.
Oh, the book blog.
Yep.
Because I gotta see your. What do you?
No, there's a picture of it. Yeah.
Yeah. What do you call it? Your
second
your
story.
Your Weeble.
Oh, good. My foot.
No, I made a mistake. Windows Phone Secret. There's more
secret.
Than one.
There's more than one secret. Yeah.
There's more than one. It's plural. Secrets.com. So this is another place we can go to read Paul's stuff. Mm-hmm. Aww. He got a little phone in his hand. Is that you, Paul?
You notice he's wearing a blue shirt.
You notice that you call it an avatard.
I don't like the avatar, Leo. I just want to be very clear about that.
But you've got a little Windows phone. It's so cute. Can you put a cowboy hat on him?
You can.
I think that had macho.
I should have done that today, and I didn't think of that. Yeah. I'm sorry, Aaron.
It could be the Brokeback Mountain avatar.
There's all kinds of things wrong with what you just said, but let's just move along.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the Windows 7 app pick of the week.
I previously recommended Graphically. However, they are now out of beta, and they no longer do the Adobe Air baloney stuff. They actually have an HTML5-based site, which is beautiful. It works awesome in IE9, and it's out of beta.
Cool.
So you can go full screen with it. It navigates exactly comic books. Sorry, if you're not familiar. And I should thank Carl Kramer, who brought this to my attention. I wasn't even aware that they had done this.
Neato.
So this is actually a big improvement over the software. I've always liked the service, and they have mobile apps and, you know, different mobile experiences. But this is one for your PC. It works
pretty
great.
It's pretty awesome.
By the way, you don't have to click anything. Like, just use your keyboard. So navigate right, and it automatically expands the screen and scrolls and all that stuff as needed, so that you can navigate between the different panels. So, yeah, it's a nice presentation.
Really, really amazing.
Yeah.
Your Windows Phone 7 app pick is actually one that I love.
I know. I feel like I'm mailing these things in now because they're just, you know, we're kind of filling out the, you know, the schedule with these apps that have been on the iPhone for like 11 years. But GeoDefense is an awesome game.
So
if you haven't
fun.
It's $2.99. It's probably free on the iPhone.
They have the full Swarm one, right? I mean, where all the swarms. Yeah. I cannot stop playing this.
Classic.
Yeah. It's really now these are tower defense games. So people don't know what they are. They're you have to defend.
And eventually we're going to hit Angry Birds, and you know, that's how this summer is going to go. So
yeah, this is one of the most challenging and yet most fun tower defense games out there, and it's visually very cool. It doesn't have, like, you know, little avatars, but it's actually that's one of the reasons I like it. It's just a little more abstract.
Been a good month though for these. You know, I don't know what the promotion is, but they're starting to ship a bunch of these tier one games now. Hydro Thunder was another one that's kind of a boat racing game.
That's a measure of the success of the platform. It means that there's enough
Doodle Jump, obviously.
Yeah, that's worth. Would you agree, Aaron? I mean, you're a mobile developer.
Oh yeah.
At some point, you start. You know, you iPhone developers started looking at Android, and at some point when it's obvious Windows Phone 7 is big enough, you start developing for that.
For sure.
It's a resource game, you know. This is such a fun game. I'm stuck, by the way, at line. I can't remember what level, but it's tough after you go for a while. And look how beautiful it is. It's just really sweet. So that's called Geo Defense now on Windows Phone 7. And your Audible pick
is awesome,
but don't say it because I don't think
I want to say it so bad. I almost
you're not allowed.
You have to promise me that this is going to happen in the next week
or two.
Because
be on, they sent me a note,
okay,
saying they've actually sending me the book,
yeah,
and saying please don't say anything about it until Sunday.
Really?
Yeah,
because I've already purchased it.
Yeah, it's available. I'm not sure why. I don't know what the deal is.
I have a lot to say about this book and about the history of it, the movies that have been made about it, and then also the guy who narrates it. The whole thing is awesome.
I hated the movie, to be honest with you.
I love the movie.
Did you like
but
the movie?
I really did, but it's not. I agree that it's not for everyone.
So for some reason,
there are two movies, by the way.
Yeah, Soderbergh did one, and then Cameron did one, right?
No. There's an earlier. There was one made in Russia.
Oh, I didn't see that one.
It's on Netflix.
Oh, good. I'll watch it.
Look this up on Netflix. If you didn't like the American one, you're not going to like this one. It's even slower moving, but it's fascinating because we shouldn't talk about this. But
we've given them enough clues that they could figure out what it is if they really care. And otherwise, it should be actually. I should be getting it today. So I'm really thrilled that you recommended it. I can't wait to listen to it.
This is the rare example. No, I don't know. That's not fair. This is a good example of a book that the audiobook is actually the one to get.
Yeah.
And it is what I did.
And by the way, you're right. It is Hudson Hawk. Very good. Congratulations. You all figured it out.
No, it's not Hudson Hawk. It's not that good, but it's.
Paul, the chat room agrees this is the best Windows Weekly ever.
Okay.
Because, wow. Because we came to fisticuffs.
Oh, I see. Well, I can't promise that every week.
Oh, come on. Let's battle it out. Ironically, it was you and me.
I was emboldened by the appearance of Aaron.
It was you and me who fought, and Aaron was very gentlemanly about the whole thing, even though
even though I'm the Mac guy.
A Mac guy.
I have a quick recommendation. Okay. So lately, I've been helping a lot of people become programmers. You know, when there's a lot of innovation going on in the mobile space, and people who are not previously programmers want to become programmers. And so I needed some way to sort of explain the programmer life to them.
Great.
And there's a great book, which is not new, but it seems like it's more appropriate than ever right now, which is Dreaming in Code.
Oh, I love that book.
It's a great book. And if you're thinking about doing some programming or you want to understand the programming culture, it's a really good read.
Scott Rosenberg.
Yes.
Really, really. I love Scott for one thing. But he wrote this by interviewing programmers, right?
Well, he followed a project. So Mitch Kapoor, after doing Lotus 1-2-3, went off to do an open source personal information manager.
I remember this.
Oh,
I
yes.
Was Evolution. Was it Evolution?
What was the name
Chandler,
of that?
That's it.
Chandler Project. And it's all about how difficult that project was.
It's funny that you should say this, because Paul and I have talked many times about how much we loved books like The Soul of the New Machine or Showstopper. These books that about the inside of a project. This is one of them.
And I think this is one of the best.
Oh, I'm so glad you mentioned that. I forgot all about this.
Huh.
Good choice. And I love Scott Rosenberg. He's just a great guy. Paul Thurrott is at the SuperSite for Windows, winsupersite.com. He also has, we don't plug it enough. I should plug it, although it's linked from WinSuperSite.
Oh, Leo, my goodness. I have something to tell you. This is from Raphael, actually. This is beautiful. You'll enjoy this.
Yes.
Skype on Windows PCs. Do you know what it was written in?
No.
Delphi.
What?
Yep, look it up.
No. The whole thing?
Yeah.
Not just on the Windows. UI?
Yeah, I mean, like the Mac version was written in Objective-C, but the Windows version was written in Delphi.
Delphi. That just shows you the power of Delphi. And that's why.
I have this, which means it's possible that this person who wrote Skype has a copy of my book somewhere. And that maybe, just maybe, he owes me money.
Sue him! He stole all of the code.
Some small slice.
From the Delphi 3 Super Bible. Not available in stores.
I hate you both.
That just gives him street cred, though. You know, Delphi is basically basic with a lot of great libraries. I mean, not basic. Right, Pascal with a lot of great libraries.
You know, you thought I was upset about Windows 8, but what you just said is ridiculous.
No, I know. I apologize. I meant Pascal, which is a beloved language for Macintosh programmers. That's the original language for Macintosh was
Pascal. Think Pascal, right?
Think Pascal was a great one, but actually Apple had its own programmers workshop with Pascal.
I remember Think Pascal.
Yeah, Think was very good. It was very fast. Think C was my favorite. But Aaron doesn't care about this.
I don't care about that.
He arrived later. He arrived after System 9 went away.
Into the Apple world.
Yeah. Really fun. I love these kinds of shows, and I'm great. I'm just grateful that we could have these conversations and still have a man crush on one another. Paul Thurrott is at the SuperSite.
I would hug you now if I could.
Oh, screw you, Thurrott. And I'm just feigning affection. And no,
I would still hug you.
No,
bastard.
I adore Paul. You beautiful bastard, you. Aaron Hillegass, always a pleasure to have you in. Nerd Ranch is not located, unfortunately, anywhere near us.
It is in Atlanta, Georgia.
But it's beautiful out in the countryside there.
It is.
Yep. And a great place to go, stay, and learn. So bignerdranch.com to find out more. Thank you all for joining us. We do Windows Weekly. Actually, this one was kind of funny because those of you listening at home now, I can tell the tale. The show began in the middle. I decided we were having such a great discussion. I said, roll tape. And then we recorded an open later. But this show normally will begin its day at 11 a.m. Pacific. That's 2 p.m. Eastern at live.twit.tv. Do watch live because you're always going to get more if you watch live. But if you can't watch live, it's always great to download it. Do both. twit.tv/dubdub for Windows Weekly, or get it on iTunes and all the other usual places, including the Zune Marketplace. Thanks to Paul Greenlee, who does a great job of keeping us front and center on the Zune Marketplace. Is that what they call it, the Zune Marketplace?
For now.
For how long?
I don't know.
How long?
We might just call it the marketplace.
Let's just call it the marketplace. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, sir.
Well,
thank
you, Aaron. Next time. Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you, Leo.
On Windows Weekly.